Here's an interesting phrase from Mark Sisson's book, The Primal Blueprint, What Our Genes Truly Crave. If you get comfortable with this sort of thinking, you can give practically anything you want an evolutionary justification. You could say, my genes are hungry, or adultery is in my genes. It's sort of a paleologic version of listening to your heart, or even obeying the voices in your head. Do you think I'm being unfair to Sisson? Then you haven't met Grok. Grok is a handy rhetorical tool for him. Will fruit make me fat? Should I consume most of my calories from meat? Well, don't worry about sorting through all that science, and certainly don't listen to expert panel recommendations on nutrition. Why assume they know what they're talking about? Just consult Sisson's imaginary caveman. Why listen to a guy like this? All that research and study has probably just confused him. You're better off imagining what this guy would have done. He may have smelled terrible, and he may have made lousy conversation, but he probably had six-pack abs. You know he loved going shirtless. Imagining what a Stone Ager would do is super easy, and it just feels right, doesn't it? Grok is the paleologic symbol of truthiness. This is how the paleo world justifies its beliefs. See the last phrase? Our crusty imaginary friend would certainly be tipping his hat to us as we alternate gorging on meat with intermittent fasting. You just know he'd have charming mannerisms like that. Grok would probably be just this great all-round dude, you know? Of course, the ladies would have loved him. Most women these days would melt for a guy who could bring down a woolly mammoth. You can signal you are that guy by taking Sisson's advice and grunting and growling at the gym. The gym is the right place to play out your paleo fantasies of tearing apart giant prehistoric beasts. If anyone thinks you're being uncivilized, that's their problem. As Sisson says, if people are offended, they shouldn't be in a gym. You'll be feeling your primal best, and the ladies will be sure to notice. Sisson does have a knack for connecting with adolescent boys of all ages. Unfortunately, channeling one's inner barbarian doesn't seem to help paleo promoters agree on some basic nutrition issues. On one hand, you have modern-day paleo radiologist Kurt Harris arguing plant compounds are not essential. This is worth hitting pause to read. He seems to be creating a bit of a straw man, implying that someone out there says there is a single phytochemical that is indispensable to human health. I have never heard such an argument put forth, but just in case someone does, Dr. Harris is all over it. However, I'm not sure he has really addressed whether phytochemicals in edible plants are good for us. On the other hand, Lauren Cordain believes phytochemicals are worth eating if you want to reduce your risk of cancer. Did he ask his genome what it craved to figure this out? Both of these guys are on the cutting edge of that big paradigm shift to paleo. Why don't they agree on something so basic then? This is not the only example of paleologic leading to very different conclusions. From the beginning, the paleo diet idea was sold as something really different from low carb, even though it was low carb. Those other low carb diets were hazardous. This low carb was better, because it was closer to the recommendations of major health institutions like the American Cancer Society. Well, if these institutions are the ultimate source of validation for a diet, why then do we need the paleo idea? Why not just see what the American Cancer Society says directly? Let's see, fruits, vegetables, cutting out modern abominations like fries, donuts, and sodas. Hey, they are doing paleo! Except, they also say you should eat whole grains and limit red meat. Man, it's too bad they messed that part up, isn't it? I guess they never consulted Grok. Here's Lauren Cordain calling all the other low-carb diets irresponsible. Well, they would have to be. There is only one original, biologically appropriate diet for all humans, and he's trademarked the name of it. You see, the paleo diet is indeed low-carb, but it's not like them. It has a big idea. Those other low-carb diets, on the other hand, can be lethal. But wait a moment. The paleo diet is modeled on hunter-gatherer diets. What did hunter-gatherers actually eat? Were they staying away from lethal fats back in 1922, long before industrialized foods might have entered their diets? It seems they really liked the parts that were most loaded with saturated fat. It even looks like Apache Indians did not mind parting with the lean meat Cordain says is so healthy. By the way, just imagine eating fresh, hot, raw, bloody bison liver by the handful. Yikes. Going back much further, you can see that hominids may have prioritized the fat in a carcass too. Some Stone Age diet proponents use information like this to argue for eating lots of animal fat. In an unforgiving ice age, that might make sense, right? They could use those calories to add body fat. Lauren Cordain does seem just a bit off when he says Paleo Man ate a diet that would have burned off his fat reserves. Isn't his idea of fighting a battle of the bulge with his diet a little more modern-day vanity rather than evolutionary science? Ignoring for now the question of whether or not eating a lot of protein will make your fat simply melt away, what survival advantage would a Paleolithic human have found in being skinny? Would a fast metabolism have been an asset in a struggle to survive? I'm just getting started with showing you how paleologic has led to some seriously conflicting beliefs. There is more ahead in part 2.